Good morning. It's good to see everybody this morning. How many this week have went, oh my goodness, why am I so stinking tired? How many of that time change just messed you up? I'm still trying to get on track. I'm an early riser and I just am having a problem. And my brackets are a mess. If you don't know what that means, okay, but anybody ever fill out a bracket and you're like, I'm done. Okay, all right. Hey, if you're a first-time guest here today, we're glad you're here. So glad you're here. Just take a minute after church and fill out a guest card, and you can place it in the offering box or take it to Welcome Center. Church, aren't we glad for all of our guests today? Let's give them a good round of applause. Amen. Thanks for being here. Thank you so much. Let's turn our Bibles to Hebrews 12. Hebrews 12. We started this series 3 weeks ago, and it's called Beginning to Beginning. Beginning to Beginning. So we started out with his beginning. We talked about his life. Today we're going to talk about the end of Christ's life, and next week we're going to talk about our beginning. All right? So we're going to go to Hebrews 12, 2, and the title of this message is You Are His Joy. You are his joy. So why don't we just pray and ask the Lord to help us today as we enter into Passion Week. This is called Passion Week. Actually, today is considered Palm Sunday, and I'll get into that in a minute. So today is considered Palm Sunday. All right? We'll just kind of walk through in the message his week, Christ's last week on earth. So we talked about his beginning, his life. Now we're going to talk about the last week of Jesus' life. So let's pray, and then we'll read Hebrews 12, 2, and then get into the Word. So, Father, I thank you for a church that loves you. I thank you for people who get up early and come to church. I thank you that people want to worship you. And I also thank you, Lord, that we get into your Word, not only in this room, but we get into your Word in city groups, and we are discipling people. We want to be disciples of your Word. So, Lord, today as we get into your Word and this week, I pray, Father, that you give us spiritual eyes and ears to see and hear. We can read it and not get what your Word's saying. But I believe your Holy Spirit wants us to see and hear what you are saying to the church. And, Lord, as this week we remember your death, burial, and resurrection, Lord, I pray that we go through this week and through this year and through our life being thankful for what you did, because without the shedding of blood, without your death, we do not have eternal life. So as we get into your Word, help us to receive with meekness your engrafted Word. Help us, Lord, like David said, to hide your Word in our heart that we might not sin against you. Help us to make your Word a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. And as we leave here today, help us to be doers of your Word and not hearers only. In Jesus' name, and everybody who's ready to receive the Word, say amen. 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 All right. We'll start at verse 1, actually. Hebrews 11 is called the faith chapter. So it's talking about all these people who by faith inherited righteousness. So then it says, therefore, we also, since we are surrounded by so great cloud of witnesses, who are those witnesses? All the people that he listed in chapter 11 of Hebrews and all kinds of other people who have lived a life of faith. You're a great cloud of witness. So let us lay aside every weight and the sin which does so easily ensnare us, and let us run with endurance the race set before us. Now, verse 2, here's where I really want you to look now. Looking unto Jesus, it's what we're doing in our life, and that's what we're doing this week. Looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. Now, right here, here's the biggie. Who for the joy set before him? Who for the joy? Who's who? Jesus, for the joy set before him, endured the cross, despising the shame, and sat down at the right hand of God. Who for the joy set before him endured the cross? Many people in this room were in the military, and I know military people hate it when I ask this question, but if you served in any form of the military, Army, Navy, Air Force, Marine, Coast Guard, any form of military, just lift your hand up. Let me see your hand. Look around. Lift your hand up. Some of you aren't lifting your hands, and I see you not lifting your hands. I hate recognition. But thank you for doing that, right? Thanks so much. Amen. I don't think any of these men and women said, whoa, I'm going to join the military. I can't wait for them to shave my head. I can't wait for them to make me run miles with an 80-pound pack on my back. I can't wait to sleep in a tent when it's cold and possibly go to a foreign country and risk my life maybe to get blown up. And boy, that sounds joyful to me. I can't wait to do that. I can't wait for a sergeant to get in my face when I get off the bus and start screaming and yelling at me and making me do push-ups and doing all of these things. I don't think anybody said, that's why I'm doing it. That's going to be joyful. I don't think anybody did. I think our soldiers, our men and women said, here's my joy. My joy is going to be going and defending my country so that my family and my friends and the people in America can have freedom. That's why they did that. Everybody understand that? I don't think anybody did it because I want to be punished. Boy, I look forward to being punished. Anybody like being punished? I don't like being punished. I don't like pain. But they said, look, I will do this and risk my life so that my family and my country can live under the things that our founding fathers said we should live under. And that's freedom and biblical rights and all of those things. So it says, so for the joy set before him in chapter 12, verse 2 of Hebrews, the joy set before him, listen now, we are that joy. The cross wasn't his joy, and we'll get into the cross in a minute. The cross was not his joy. We are the joy set before him. He said, I know in 2016, March 20th, 2016, there are going to be people in the world, not just America, but in the world who are struggling with things, and they are looking for an answer to the hole in their heart. My joy is to die on the cross so they can have forgiveness of sins, so they can find the answer, so I can walk with them through life. That's the joy set before him. How many thankful this morning that Jesus died on the cross so that we can have eternal life? That's why he did it. Yeah. Yeah, we're the joy set before him. I'm telling you, without Christ, there's an emptiness in us. I can't imagine living in the world in 2016 and not having Christ in my life. I cannot imagine. I am so thankful for Jesus Christ and what he did for me. We do videos every once in a while. I have a video of a young lady who came to our church about 4.5 years ago. And Karen and I were doing a Bible study in our home. We were doing I don't know how many weeks we met, 10, 12 weeks, and absolutely incredible. We met in our home, and this young lady started coming to our home. And I was going, okay, what in the world's going on with this young lady? Because there was a wall there. And I want you to watch this video of this young lady. Her name's Chris. She's here this morning. I want you to watch this video about Chris, and I'll be right back.
My name is Kristen Helton. I started coming to Church on Fire about 3.5 years ago. I grew up in a Christian home. When I was 20, I married a Christian man. And my life just changed. I'm not even sure I know who that person is anymore, if I'm being honest. We were the couple that was in church every Sunday. We were constantly in church, praising the Lord on Sunday. The problem is once we left church, the situation changed pretty drastically. About 2.5 years in, I found out that he had acquired an addiction to pain meds. We tried to get him help, and it just didn't ever work out. It just escalated into a series of really, really bad circumstances. There was abuse. There was financial hardships due to his addiction. How I found out about my husband's addiction is he had gone into the ER because he was in pain and he wanted to get a back injection and they wouldn't give it to him. And so I went to his doctor, and I was like screaming and crying, you need to give my husband his injection. I'm working two jobs. He's on disability. We can't do this. And the doctor told me he's addicted to prescription pain meds. And about that time, my knees just collapsed and I hit the floor. At the time, I was 23 years old, and I really was kind of clueless to all this stuff, really naive. So it just really, when something like that happens, it really changes the dynamics and the trust of a relationship, especially when you're having this expectation of you're seeing them at church on Sunday and they're raising their hands, and, you know, when you go home and things are different. And I almost had to know when he was going to go into a fit or when he was going to start to act out, and I had to be really careful that it didn't happen around my family, and I had to lie to my family about things. Like, my brother Josh would be like, hey, what happened to your arm? And I'd have to be like, oh, well, you know, I'm just clumsy, the dog, you know, got rough with the dog. About 5 years in, I found out he had a girlfriend, so I felt biblically it was okay to leave. I called my parents and I said, hey guys, I need you guys to come pick me up. And they said, what, for lunch? And I said, no, I'm moving out. So that was a shock to them. I moved out and he moved her in 7 days later. From that point, I should have been really thankful that the Lord took me out of that really bad situation, but it just made me really bitter because it wasn't the life I wanted. I wanted kids and I wanted to be a wife and I wanted to do real estate with him. And therein lies the problem. It was about what I wanted. And I think the Lord really, he really showed me that later on. After the divorce, just Satan really, really came in and just, you know, used that to just attack every aspect of what I believe and what I stood for. So he just came in and he was like, you don't need to date Christian men. You know what to expect out of men out of the world. You only know what to expect out of what men show you on Sunday mornings if they go to church. It just really changed everything. And it changed who I was as a person. I was living with a guy, which I know that's wrong, and I know I shouldn't have been doing that. I was living with a guy when I started coming to church here. The Lord started convicting me about the way I was living my life. He used a verse in Romans saying, the problem's not with the law, the problem's with you. And I'm pretty stubborn and strong-willed, so it took a lot. It took a year and a half probably of healing and just getting me on the right track. So I really took the next year and a half for the Lord to just almost reprogram my brain about how I felt about Christian men, how I felt about myself and who I was, learning who I was in Christ. The first time I met Evan, when I first started coming to church here, I saw him kiss Tiff and the boys, and the first thing that entered my mind was, I wonder how he treats them at home. And that's terrible, and Evan's an awesome person, and I should have never thought that, but that's what I'm talking about when it came to reprogramming my brain. I can honestly say he's faithful, and he will change, and he will renew you, and he will restore you to something that you can't even imagine. When I was at my lowest point and I was in my word, he sustained me and he got me through it through his word. And knowing that he rejoices when we are healed and when we are, you know, brought to this place where we know we are forgiven, and he rejoices. And just to know that my Heavenly Father rejoices at the fact that I came back to him, what greater gift is that, really? That our Heavenly Father cares about us that much, that he is willing to go to the cross. He's willing to take that for us. And he rejoices in it at the end of the day. He rejoices in that. I'm living proof that God can rescue you and make you new.
Awesome. Like I said, Chris and her mom and dad came to our house for a Bible study, and people were showing up, and I'm at the front door like, yay, welcome, hugging. I'll kiss guys on the cheek and kiss ladies on the floor. I probably shouldn't do that. So anyway, Karen's like, oh, you probably should. And I'm hugging, I want to hug Chris, and she's like pushing away like this wall is up. And I've seen that wall, not that hugging makes you not have that wall, but I saw that wall begin to collapse. I've seen her turn into this leader of young ladies. I'm serious. She's taking mission trips now, and God's just revolutionized her life. I want her to stand up. Chris, stand up right there. That's Chris. Amen. Love you, Chris. And that's her mom and dad. Mom and dad, wave your hands. Doug, all right. All right. So he went to the cross for us to redeem us. Maybe you're in here and that story just really touched your heart. Listen, that's why he died, to redeem us from the curse of the law, sin, and death. So let's talk about, since today is Palm Sunday, let's talk about Christ last week. Let's talk about kind of what happened in that last week, all right? So, Palm Sunday, today, John 12:12, I want us to look at this, and it describes why we talk today as Palm Sunday. Let's put it on the screen, guys. Psalm 12:12. The next day, a great multitude that had come to the feast, when they heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem, took branches of palm trees and went out to meet him and cried out. Look at Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, the King of Israel. They took palm branches while he's riding this donkey. Many took their coats and they laid them out so that he was coming into Jerusalem. They're crying out, Hosanna, Hosanna, and doing palm branches. That's why this is called Palm Sunday. That's what happened. But how quickly this whole thing changed. This whole thing changed. So he said to his disciples, okay, guys, going to town, there's a room, we're going to go to this room, and it's described in Matthew 26:18, him going to, telling his disciples to go to this room so he can celebrate Passover. Real quick, here's what Passover meant to the children of Israel. The last plague in Egypt, when the children of Israel were leaving Egypt, was the Passover, when it's described that a death angel came and the firstborn of every family would die. But if the children of Israel or anyone put the blood of a lamb over the doorpost of their house, that death angel would pass over them. And so the children of Israel celebrated Passover. So Jesus said, guys, he said, go into a city to a certain man and say to him, the teacher says, my time is at hand. I will keep Passover at your house with my disciples. Then skip down to verse 26 and look at Passover, what happened in Egypt, and look at what Jesus is doing for us. And he institutes right here in this scripture communion and remembering what he did. And as they were eating, Jesus took bread, blessed it, broke it, and gave it to the disciples and said, take, eat, this is my body. That's communion. That's the first person to ever take communion was Jesus Christ with his disciples. It's the same as Passover. He's saying, look, you used to remember Passover. Now I want you to remember what I'm doing for you on the cross. Then he took a cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, drink from it, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for many for the remissions of sins. But I say to you, I will not drink of this fruit of the vine from now on until the day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom. And when they had sung a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. So he said, let's celebrate Passover when the firstborn would die and they put blood over the doorpost. Now I'm instituting, I'm about to die on the cross, guys, which is a type and shadow of Passover. What's happening is now I'm going to shed my blood so that you can have forgiveness of sin, so that you can have eternal life. So he said, okay, we're finished. Let's go to the Mount of Olives, which isn't that far. I was talking to somebody the other day about it. I've been to Israel. It may be as far as here, from here to maybe the corner of New Haven and Harrison Avenue, where the Shell station is down that way. Maybe not even that far. So they're walking, and there's this hill there, and it's called the Mount of Olives. At the bottom of that mountain is the Garden of Gethsemane. We went there. We went to the Garden of Gethsemane. There's olive trees there. It's a garden. And they told us there's olive trees here that were here when Christ was here. So that was pretty neat to think, wow, one of these olive trees, Jesus Christ could have been praying next to it. So he said, guys, let's go to the Mount of Olives. Then in verse 36, he came to the place that's called Gethsemane. That's that garden, and said to the disciples, sit here while I go over there and pray. And he took with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee, and he began to be sorrowful and in deep distress. Then he said to them, my soul is exceeding sorrowful, even to death. Stay here and watch with me. Pray with me. Then he says, he went a little farther and fell on his face and prayed, saying, oh, my Father, if it possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not what I will, but you will. We talked about this a few weeks ago. Why is he saying, my soul is in distress? I mean, even unto death, guys, please pray with me. Pray with me. I don't think Jesus thought, okay, I'm backing out of this thing. I've lived 33 years. I'm backing out now. I don't think he thought that. But in the human side of Christ, which he had a human side to him, he knew what was about to happen. I saw a doctor's report on the crucifixion. I watched a doctor talk about crucifixion, and he said, it is actually possible when a person is in such great distress that when they're in stress, blood vessels can break near their sweat glands, and they can sweat blood. And it says he did that. He was under such stress and strain, it says his sweat became as great drops of blood. And he said, my God, if it's possible, if there's any way humanity can be saved outside of this, let's go for it. But if not, your will be done. I'm ready to go to the cross. He knew that in a few minutes, Judas was going to come with soldiers and take him into the worst day anyone could ever face. The worst day anyone could ever face. And let's keep this in mind as we go into the next, what did he face? Let's keep in mind, folks, keep this in mind as we go forward. He did it for us. If there was just me, he would have done it for me. If it was just you, he would have done it for you. He died a horrible death just for us. So Hebrews 12:2 says, for the joy set before him. What did he endure? Now, this is where it's going to get a little graphic. It's going to get a little graphic, so I just want to prepare you. But I can't not say it because it's what he went through. It's what he really went through. First of all, he went through betrayal. How many have ever been betrayed by a close friend? The Bible says that the wounds of a friend, man, they hurt. A close friend who turns and turns on you, I think that's the worst. That's some of the worst pain you can face. You know what? Going through divorce with somebody that you loved, that's a hard thing to go through. Many of you have been through it. Let me say this. God hates divorce. Why does God hate divorce? He doesn't go, oh, I hate you because you... He hates it because divorce hurts people so bad. It crushes people. It hurts people. And he says, I want you to love one another in the church, because when a betrayal happens between the body of Christ, it hurts. It's the worst pain you can have. So, and while he was still speaking, Matthew 26, behold, Judas, one of the 12, and with a multitude of swords and clubs, came with the chief priests and elders of the people. Now his betrayer had given them a sign. Who's his betrayer? Judas, a man who'd walked with him for 3.5 years. He said, whomever I kiss, he is the one, seize him. And immediately went up to Jesus and said, greetings, Rabbi, and kissed him. He betrayed him. Actually, we don't go so far as calling this betrayal, but his disciples left him as well. Judas denied him. That had to hurt. Now, I want you to look at this scripture, and I'm going to go into this just for a minute, because we read it and we go right past it. It's kind of just, here, we'll just throw this word in there and move past it. Matthew 27:26 now. Then they released Barabbas to them. They cried out. Pontius Pilate said, who do you want me to release to you, Jesus or Barabbas? It was their custom to let somebody go at this time of year. They said, release to us Barabbas. Barabbas, release to us a criminal, possibly a murderer. Release him. And now look, and when he had scourged Jesus, he delivered him to be crucified. We read past that, scourged. So I went online, I just looked up Roman scourging. It was the Romans that scourged him. So they would take a person like Jesus who was going to be scourged. And they had these guys that were the institutors of the scourging. And then there was a centurion there who was watching this and going, okay, this is how far I'll let you go. It was a scourging. They would take the garment off of the person and they would pull them tight and make it so their skin was tight as they took a thing called a cat of nine tails. I want to put that up there and I want us to just see that. And in those knots, many times they would put bone or pieces of metal, or they would put at the end a hook sometimes, and they called that hook the scorpion. And so they would stretch this person out, and they were allowed to take that thing and hit somebody 40 times. 40 times. And there's 9 whips on that. So you multiply that out. Let's take that down. And they would whip them, and they would whip them, and they would whip them, and they would whip them. And it would pull flesh out. It would rip through their skin. And the centurion would watch because many people died from that. They didn't even make it, but they were like, the centurion would watch and say, okay, this guy's about to die. Let's stop the whipping so he can live, so we can hang him on a cross. It was so brutal and so hard that many of the people didn't make it through. The centurion would check, okay, he's about to die. Stop so we can keep punishing him. That's the first thing Jesus went through. I want you to look at this next one in Matthew 27, 29. And when they had twisted a crown of thorns, they put it on his head. I want to put a picture up of a crown of thorns. And we, you know, listen, this isn't a rose bush kind of thorn. These were thorns that could have been at least 2 inches long. Karen and I brought some of them home with us and kept them. So I want you to just see that. Now let's go back to scripture. They put it on his head. Now look, and a reed in his right hand, and they bowed their knee before him and mocked him, saying, Hail, King of the Jews. Hail, King of the Jews. Then they spat on him, and they took the reed and struck him on the head. He's got this crown on his head. Now his back is just raw meat. And I forgot to say this, in scourging, I read this that many times they would take salt and throw on the back where they had just scourged him. They put the thorn on his head, and your head, the blood vessels are very close. There's not much there for the skin. I was walking through the woods one time looking at something on the ground. I'm walking with my head down, and I ran into a barbed wire fence, and it stuck in my head. And so I'm trying to get this barbed wire fence, you know, just one of them, is stuck in my head, and I'm thinking, and I can't figure out which way it's going in, so I just pull back, and it kind of popped and ripped my head a little bit, and I'm like, all right, I'm good. And I started walking. Pretty soon, I'm like, I feel something running down my face. It's just one little spot. Blood's running down my nose and dripping off my nose, and I'm like, whoa. Blood's dripping down because of one little. Can you imagine having a crown of thorns placed on your head and they're hitting you with reeds with an inch and a half and blood's coming down his head? So they've whipped him, they beat him, they pulled on his beard, they punched him. They would punch him and say, prophesy to us, tell us who just punched you. They put a crown of thorns, they're hitting it with sticks. And then Matthew 27, 33, and when they had come to a place called Golgotha, that is to say the place of the skull, they gave him sour wine mingled with gall to drink, but when he had tasted it, he would not drink it. Then they crucified him and divided his garments, casting lots, that it might be fulfilled which is spoken by the prophet. They divided his garments among them, and for my clothes they cast lots. So he's on the cross now. Look now. I watch a doctor's report on this as well. All the pain that he's had in his back, crown of thorns on his head. He's been betrayed by Peter. The disciples have left him. Now they lay him on a cross. He's carried this. They didn't carry the whole cross. They just carried the cross member. They laid him down, and they put nails, it's believed, not here, but this is considered part of your hand, right here, so that it would hold. Nails, not 16 penny nails, big spikes through his wrists and through his feet. Now he's on the cross. And this doctor said that there's nerve endings right here and here. And in order to breathe, these guys would have to push up on nails, nailed through their feet, and hold with their arms so they could get a breath. And then when they'd go back down, all the weight would be back on their wrist. No matter where they went, they're in excruciating pain, not counting a crown of thorns, not counting all the things that happened on their back. Excruciating pain. And soldiers would come so that they could end their suffering finally and break people's legs. They would break their legs so they couldn't push up and breathe anymore, and they would suffocate. So Jesus is up there on the cross, and verse 45 says, now from the sixth hour until the ninth hour, there was darkness on the land. He was there for 6 hours on the cross. And about the ninth hour, Jesus cried out with a loud voice saying, Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani. My God, why have you forsaken me? At that point, look, church, all of our sins went on Christ. Everything that we've done, everything that we will do, went on Christ on the cross. And the Father said, I can't look at you because of your sin. And he died. I want you to watch this video. And let's remember what happened to Christ and what went on this week. Okay? All right.
We are made. sacrifice that was strong enough to save us rose in victory to let the whole world see. Oh, love has made a way. Hope is never lost. There's power in the cross. Oh, love has made a way. Hope is never lost. There's power.
Let's bow our heads. Let's just leave everything the way it is. Ask us to pray. If you're in here and you don't know Christ, He did that for you so you could come to know Him as Lord and Savior, for our sins to be taken away. So I want us all to pray right now. We're just going to pray together, every one of us. Let's pray this prayer. Maybe you don't know Christ. Pray this prayer with me today. Can we pray this together? Jesus, let's say it again. Jesus, I believe you're the Son of God. I believe you came to this earth. I believe you died on the cross to forgive me for my sins. I confess I'm a sinner. Please forgive me. Forgive me for my sins. Take them away from my life. Jesus, I ask you to come into my life and walk with me through this life. Help me, Father. Help me, Father. I need your help today. I confess you are Lord. In Jesus' name. Listen, if you prayed that this morning and you didn't know Christ, I want you to take a card that's in the seat. It's got green at the top. Put your name on it and just check at the bottom, my decision today. I'm committing my life to Christ, and all we're going to do is write you a letter and tell you how to get in a growth track. Okay? And bless you, we believe God sent Christ for healing in our body. We believe God can heal every marriage. We believe God can touch our finances. We believe God can touch our health. So come down for prayer. But let me bless us. Let's join hands with our spouse right now as we leave this morning. Father, bless our marriages. Everybody say that together. Father, bless my marriage. Bless us with protection and health. Bless us with joy in our home in Jesus' name. Touch us, Father, we pray in the name of Jesus. If you have kids, let's say this. Father, bless my children. Come on, everybody say, bless my children, that they serve you with all their heart, soul, mind, and strength. Lord, protect our children. When they aren't in our watch, they can't be in our watch 24 hours a day. Bless them, protect them in Jesus' name. Be with them, Father, we pray. Father, bless the singles that are here today and be with them. Bless them as they go through this week. And Lord, those that are a widow or a widower, someone who's lost their spouse, we ask you to bless them in Jesus' name. Church, the Lord bless you and keep you and make his face shine upon you, be gracious unto you and give you peace. Say it with me real good. In the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Spirit. Amen. 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 Let's leave and remember this week the passion of what Christ went.
Strong enough to see.